introduce Professor Aristotle Tympas from the National and Kapodistrian University of Athens, but not the Computer Science Department, Informatics and Telecommunications Department, but the Department of Philosophy. Is it in History of Science, or is it History and Philosophy of Science? Same thing. Professor Tympas has a PhD in History, Technology and Society, and an MSc in Technology and Science Policy, both from Georgia Tech in the U.S., a diploma in Chemical Engineering from the Aristotle University of Thessaloniki, and he is a professor, as I said, at the History and Philosophy of Science Department. He is a specialist in the study of computing and related technologies from the perspective of history and the rest of the humanities and the social sciences. He has written books and articles that pay attention to the gender-technology relationship. He currently serves as chair of the Management Committee of the Tensions of Europe Research Network on History, Technology, and Europe, and is also the vice president and scientific coordinator and director of various other initiatives and of the graduate program Science, Technology, Society, Science, and Technology Studies. Please welcome Professor Tympas.
Hello. I would like to start by thanking the organizers for this opportunity to share with you some thoughts on the same issue. The argument will be the same as the other three keynote speakers. I will just rely on history to make the case, as I said, from the same perspective. This is the title of my talk, Invisible Mechanism of Reproduction of Gender Stereotypes in Computing, Findings from the Humanities. It will be mostly history of technology, but also the interdisciplinary field known as Science Technology Society, STS. I will share with you three critical episodes from the history of computing, all involving a gender dimension. First episode, human computers. Before the 1940s, the concept computer was not used in connection machines, it was used in connection to people, humans working in order to produce computations. They were called human computers or computers, and we will see, or computers, and we will see some examples of them. So the first episode is to do with gender and computing before the electronic computer. I purposely chose to focus on a history that will contrast the future of two graduates of the MIT Master of Science Electrical Engineering class of 1919, one man and one woman. Both, they were masters of computing history, and as we will see, they were both pioneers of today's computing technology. Now, the name of the male protagonist of our story is Vannevar Bush. You can see him to the left. He became extremely famous. Here is a cover of Time magazine in the post-World War II period. You will see more on him. He graduated in 1919 from MIT, from the Electrical Engineering Department, and he was immediately offered a position as professor at the Electrical Engineering Department. You can find him if you go to primary sources pretty much everywhere, including the cover of magazines that circulate worldwide. On the other hand, we can see the other protagonist of our story on the top left picture. Her name was Edith Clark, graduate of the same class, classmate of Vannevar Bush. And in order to find a picture of her, I had to spend quite some time at some obscure MIT and General Electric archives, because there are no pictures of her, very few. This particular one comes from a newsletter, just a corporate newsletter called The Monograph. Let's start with Vannevar Bush. Here is one of the many monographs of him. He has been called engineer of the elect of the American century. If the 20th century has been a technological century, it's actually made, engineered by technology, he may be the exemplar of an engineer who contributed to this. He was, as I said, professor of electrical engineering, specialist in computing technology in the 1920s and the 1930s. He became head of research at the Rockefeller Foundation. During World War II, he was the one who was in charge of the Manhattan Project. The Manhattan Project means the atomic bomb. And after World War II, the winners, the Americans and their allies, in this case the Americans, decided that science was very crucial when it came to win the war. So Vannevar Bush became the first science advisor to an American president. He is really the exemplar of an engineer shaping the century, shaping the history of the 20th century. This is the biography to the right. I copied it from Wikipedia, so that it's on record. The important thing is, as I said, that he graduated in 1919 and he was immediately offered this position, which led him to this incredible career, distinguished career in electrical engineering. What about Edith Clark? Go and check, please. I know you cannot see there the entry on Edith Clark, which is much more, of course, on Wikipedia. She was as good as he was. I actually have a copy from archives from the dissertation advisor of both, Vannevar Bush and Edith Clark, in which he states that he was an outstanding student, the best in her class, just like Vannevar Bush. However, when he finished in 1919, the only job that she could get was the job of a computer, a human computer, working in order to produce computations in an office, getting a low salary, a cooperative low salary. He didn't like this. He went to Turkey. He taught for a while at the college. And it was only at the age of 65 that she managed to get a faculty position in electrical engineering. It's very interesting that she actually, of whom most likely you never heard before, she is the first person to get an electrical engineering degree at MIT, and the first person to get a faculty position in the United States in electrical engineering. Yet we know very little of her. Her contributions were incredible too. In 1925, she got a patent. The most pressing computational issue problem back then was how to calculate the lengthening and the interconnection of electricity transmission lines. It was a very complex issue from a computing viewpoint, and she devised this complex article that you can see. It's a combination of calculating graphs and calculating scales. She got a patent on it while working in General Electric as a humble computer. She got a patent, and this was one of her many contributions. Vannevar Bush, however, at the same time, the same year, 1925, he was in charge of the project that led to the formation of the construction of the differential analyzer, the artifact that you can see here, which is considered an exemplar of analog computing. To be very honest with you, I'm not sure which one was more useful in the actual context of computing electrification, because the artifact by Edith Clark, going back to some points that Yannis made earlier today, and Gerald also made, is that her artifacts, for example, were not the best when it came to efficiency, computing efficiency, but they were great when it was, when the criterion of choice was computing compactness. They could be carried along in the field, down where the work had to be done, whereas the other one was a huge artifact. More on contrast of computing variables later in the presentation. Now, both of them wrote very influential books. The one to the right is a book by Vannevar Bush, well-known book. He wrote it with Nobel winner, the founder of cybernetics. Operational circuit analysis. His expertise was engineering mathematics, computational mathematics. That's what this is all about. But Edith Clark also wrote a book on the same topic, equally important, of which we know very little. In 1995, the first article on Edith Clark was written by James Britton. He was my first professor at Georgia Tech, history of technology professor. A very conservative historian, I may say, an internalist historian, I would say today, but also a very professional historian. He didn't care about the political ideologies of the actors that he was writing about. He was very fair in getting the record straight. So he discovered the history of Edith Clark, and in 1985, he wrote this article, From Computer to Electrical Engineer. the remarkable career of Edith Clark. It came out in IEEE Explorer. James Britten was not only an historian of technology, he was also chosen by IEEE to become the fellow historian. Those of you who may go back to electrical engineering and computer engineering journals of the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, you will find certain pieces within engineering articles on the history of engineering. For today's presentation, I want to check how many people, how many historians have actually ever cited the article by James Britten on Edith Clark. It's two. One reference is the one that you can see on the top, and the other one is one, actually, it's not, it's deceiving. It's only me in a recent book that I published. That can tell you how much professional historians know about this person who was as good as a student, to go back to some of the things that you heard earlier today about how women can be as good as men, and how influential she was in the immediate environment of state-of-the-art computing in the context of the interwar period. So that was episode one. In episode one, I was based on my own actually research of a story of a typical computer, which was untypical in the sense that she was just as exceptional as any other male of that period. Let's go to a famous story now, not from my own research. It refers to the start of electronic computing. The start of electronic computing supposedly happened in the 1940s in the context of the war, when this famous artifact, the ENIAC computer, was constructed by the army in order to help with ballistic computations on how to correct the trajectory, how to compute the trajectory of a bomb, for example, an atomic bomb. It's very interesting, but it's not part of a story. We focus on gender now, that this computer was never actually used. And we know all this about a computer that could not get on an airplane because it was just huge. Whereas we know very little about all the computers that were actually used in the context of World War II, including the computing bomb site that was used in order to drop the atomic bomb. But that's another story. Let's focus on cultural history, or better, history of ideology. How the army, at the end of World War II, chose to communicate this computer, thereby inaugurating a tradition, inventing a tradition of presenting this computer as the one that launched the electronic era. The picture to the left is actually a picture with a man standing in the middle. Imagine a room like this, a male standing in the middle, and we can see some women around doing something. That's not the picture that the army delivered at the press conference to hundreds of journalists. The army took a pair of scissors and cropped out of the picture the women. So the picture delivered by the army is the one to the right, without the women. It's the full, as I say here, and the manufactured ENIAC picture. This is not the only problem. As we very well know, all of us who take pictures, and I believe that the vast majority of us take pictures, taking pictures is not something new. For example, you could take a picture that was placing the man in the middle at the center of attention, or you could place the emphasis on women that were actually doing some challenging work, like the women computers from the same ranks as Edith Clark's, that were hired in order to work with the ENIAC computer. And the question here is the following. By using a pair of scissors, by cropping out certain parts of the picture, in this case, the women working with the ENIAC, what was it that was left out? The first and obvious answer has been given by Jennifer Light, professor at the Science Technology Department at MIT, Science Technology Society Department at MIT, is that the women were left out. That's a very important fact, to know a pattern in computing history of obscuring the contribution of women at very critical episodes and shaping episodes in the history of computing. But it's not just that. And that's, I will very briefly, without going into much technical detail, I will point to what was socially left out. The first thing is that was left out of the picture is the analog part. If you see the picture, let me go back to the picture. Let's keep this picture here. If you look at the main, if the focus is on the main doing the switch on off of the machine, then that is a digital process. But if you actually look at what the women to the right were doing, it's a whole different story. They are plugging and replugging the computer, the switches, so as to set up the computer, in technical terminology, to make the computer analogous to the computable. That's a work that had to be done every time, then and now. So the analog part, the production of the analogy, that was a laborious process and was done by women over the course of 2 weeks, each time the problem was new, was left out in order to show a picture of an artifact that could calculate and answer questions in 3 minutes. Let me go back to the... Let's look again at what the army, how the army presented the artifact. It says, how much is, and then there is a square. How much do you need to calculate this? Assuming that the women who were not shown, who were concealed from the picture, had worked for 2 weeks to set up the computer, then the answer was 2 seconds. In 2 seconds, this giant brain could give you an answer. But if you were to show, if you were to take into account the picture of the women beforehand, in 10, 15 years, this would be called programming. At the time, that was not the concept. If you were to take into account, let's say, this programming work, then that's a whole different answer. So, where do we focus on? The digital switch or the analog setup? The hardware machine or the software labor? And we know how important software became. They were thinking at the time that everything was to be done by the superior artifact machine. It turned out that through the history of software, and in the history of software, we have all the proof that we want that it was software that mattered more than hardware. And also here, what we can see, I'm going to follow on the distinction between men and women in computing, but I will actually introduce, for reasons of accuracy, terms that refer to gender, like masculine and feminine. The artifact, the alien, was presented as a masculine artifact, leaving out the feminine side of it. Third episode. We started with a prehistory of electronic computing. I don't like the term, but let's call it like this. And we saw an example of a human computer. Then we saw a group of human female computers at work at this defining episode of the history of electronic computing. Let's move on to the 1980s, a more familiar period to most of us. There is no PC in the early 1970s. There are just big mainframes. And the PC, and many people are experimenting with a version of a computer that could be used at home. This is what this story is going to be about, and this time I'm not going to refer back to my past work, my dissertation work on the US history of the interwar period, nor to the history by Jennifer Ladd. This will be history that we are doing, that we are producing over our university, the National Kapodistrian University of Athens, together with a group of colleagues. To link it to the previous presentations, there's definitely a problem that is a multifaceted problem. First, while there are no legal restrictions and no legal inequalities when it comes to men and women, boys and girls, we are still observing limits in the number of women who are deciding to pursue a career in computing education, in the number of women who are getting well-paid jobs after graduations, and in the ambitions of women after graduating and having the same degree as their male colleagues. That's a problem. We saw a wonderful exposition of the problem in the numbers given to us earlier today in the case of Greece. So the IEEE Society, the ACM is also active on this front, asked a number of colleagues worldwide to try to give their own answer as to why this is happening. So what I'm going to show you now, this third episode, is to do with a provisional answer that we gave here in Athens through our own research. The chapter from this book that a group of us worked together to produce is called Constructing Gender and Technology in Advertising Images. I will read the subtitle because I think it's important to keep it in mind. Feminine and masculine computer parts. Instead of assuming that computing is something that attracts only males, as it is traditionally assumed, and women are repelled from the computer, we are actually arguing in this article that both men and women are attracted by these advancements to computing. And that explains why women are massively working with computers. But let's see what exactly these advertisements were encouraging women to do with computers. In presenting you the findings, let me actually go first over the findings and then I will tell you the argument. I'm not sure how well you can see the picture to the left. It's a man sitting in front of one of the first PC pieces in Greece. It's an advertisement, but he's not looking at the PC. He's holding the phone. He is relaxed, he is not computing, he is just talking on the phone. Actually, it's like a dictaphone calling the female who is a floor below. What's the problem with this advertisement as an historian? None. I'm not making a judgment, a valid judgment. But it becomes a problem when after reviewing Computer for All for 30 years, it's a Greek journal that was published in 1983 and is still being published. Another Greek journal, home technology journal, called RAM, both of them very popular. And every other home technology journal that there was out there in Greece, we discovered that in hundreds of commercials, advertisements of these kinds, never, never, ever, a male is actually working with a computer. He is actually speaking on the phone. So what kind of commercials are these? How can you try to promote the computer for 30 years without actually working with a computer? That was the first puzzle.
Giving orders.
There was one exception, if I may mention it. There was a man, we have a few pictures of men sitting in front of their computer and doing something with it when they are actually, when the screen shows management graphs or scientific graphs. And you'll see why, what this points to. But let's start with a basic fact. Men are on the phone, whereas women are always on the keyboard. And to sweeten up what is a very hard job of basically data entry, they are putting Charlie Chaplin there to show that that's a fun job. Okay? First contrast. We started understanding that there was something going on here, and then we realized that this is also a case with all the output and the input devices. For example, when there is an open space commercial promoting the computer and there is a mouse being used, there is always a male advertising the computer. Whereas when there is a printer, it's always a female who is serving, who is waiting the mails. Okay? Third contrast. When we are talking about the hard drive, the concealed inside the black box part of the computer, it's always a genius senior computing professor who has designed. When we're talking about the screen, and what is the screen? The screen is a mirror. You are becoming, a commercial shows you what you want to become in order to obtain your gender. You are becoming a woman to the degree that you can see yourself in the screen. You can see yourself in the screen where you're sitting in the front and you're typing, not when you're on the phone and doing other jobs. So when we have ads off computer screens, it's always females. When it's ads on hard drive, it's always males. That's the full package, but we don't have time for this. But let's think of it for a second. And I may, just for a moment, make a methodological comment. I'm not a cultural historian. Nothing against cultural historians or social historians, wonderful colleagues, they do a wonderful job, but this is history of technology. If you notice it here, think of all the three contrasts that we just saw, and let's think of what it is, which part of the computer males actually are working with, are shown to be working with, and which part women are shown to be working with. The telephone and the mouse are the analog part. The male, and to be more precise, the masculine, is the one that controls the analog rage, his freedom. Whereas women, being stuck and restricted in front of the digital keyboard, are being controlled by the digital. Now let's go back to the late 70s, when there was no PC, and there were just a very few, the first PCs were appearing. What we are seeing here is not just a construction, or better, a reproduction of gender identities in the context of a technology supposedly limited. It's actually the co-construction of the artifact, the PC, and the gender identity. And to put it more accurately, the artifact, the PC, the computer, at this moment of history, emerged as an engendered artifact from the beginning. It's not that there is gender outside, and then there's the artifact, and the artifact is neutral and it's fine, and if you are a goon and you are not sexist, then you can use it in a manner that does not reproduce biases. From the beginning, right? From the beginning, we have an artifact that is engendered. And this is history of technology. I mean, it's both cultural history, gender history, but at the same time, it tells you how the very artifact is being constructed as an engender. One more point here, and I think this is actually, this needs to be mentioned. You don't see any nudity here, okay? People are dressed up, men and women. And that's what's even more dangerous. Because if an advertisement shows nudity and associates, and we have tons of advertisements of these kinds in popular magazines, and associates nudity and the female body with certain parts of the computer, then that's too easy for most of you, if not all, I'm sure all of you here, to dismiss as something that's propaganda. You understand that that's a sexist commercial. And after all, you don't buy this type of, you don't bring this type of journals at your house. But we all bring in our houses, scientists, serious home technology journals that don't have nudity. And that's what's really scary here. Because the mechanism of the reproduction of artifacts as engendered ones, in this case a computer, is concealed. It's unconscious. It becomes part of a long habituation process. And that's exactly why it's very difficult to remove. I can go to the first class, the first day of class to my history of computing students and say, oh, I'll tell you something. The computer is an artifact that has gender biases. They understand it. But ideology is not just revelation, it's habituation. And to change, to speak to the challenge that we've been talking about today, it takes a long, very long, very systematic effort to remove this long habituation to engender ideologies. Last episode, and I'll stop here. I'm not going to analyze the full picture, this famous commercial with Petroulaki. Episode 3. This is, we are now having a small research project over our group, which tries to see the follow, which tries to study what happened to computing from a gender perspective in this country and internationally in most recent years, the era of big data. This is no, the PC is now something very familiar, the gender bias has settled. We have a new round of technologies, the web, the internet, and all that, and all this rhetoric about the fourth industrial revolution and big data. So there is a thesis that we are working on, actually, that tries to see in commerce, in advertisements, in Greek newspapers, Kathimerini, Avgi, Eleftherotypia, and also in important international newspapers, British ones, in most of the cases, like the Telegraph and the Guardian. When there are articles about big data from 1911, well, from 2011 to the present, what kind of pictures do they use? What is this big data thing? How do you visualize it? How do you picture it? I think one picture is enough. There is another man, very relaxed. Of course he's not doing data entry. He's drinking his coffee, very relaxed, and just dip, dip, dip. That's the only relationship displayed when it comes to men. I will stop here, by mentioning only two of the several colleagues who are working on topics like this, either at our History of Technology program or at the new program that we have together, interdisciplinary program, together with the Department of Informatics, Yannis's department, on science, technology, and society. So the thesis on advertisements, the story that I showed you a sample from the computing advertisements from the PC era, led to actually an actual dissertation, a full-length dissertation that goes back 50 years and discovers the same, finds the same findings when it comes to mechanical calculations and all that in Greece. The other one is an ongoing master thesis at the other graduate program. Harak Konsta is the author of the PhD dissertation, Natasha and Anastasia Soli of the other one. I will stop here by just mentioning one connection, just to make a passage that will connect this historical presentation with the rest of the points being made. So in connection to what Yannis was saying, yes, what we need to do, I will now stop being an historian and I will be normative. In my opinion, what we really need to do is not turning women into men, is reevaluating, upgrading the values that we associate with feminine computing. For example, Yannis was talking about sustainability. Computing is important when it is sustainable, not only when it is efficient. Efficient is a masculine value, sustainability is a feminine value. The digital was synonymous to efficiency, interoperability, and all that. The analog, historically, was synonymous to sustainability, tolerance, diversity, all the set of values that Gerald mentioned before. So the point is not for everybody to become efficient, but it is to reevaluate the parameters and make them socially relevant. Not abstract choice of a technical parameter. What exactly do we need and for which purpose? And if we go into this, I think we will only agree that it's important to rethink the importance of the feminine side of computing. After all, and that will be my last word, you saw how important it was at the ENIAC moment and every other moment in history. Thank you very much.
We're never going to see advertisement images in the same way again.